Let's say amen for him, Pastor James.
All right, we just want to just get right back into the other part of the service. And we're going to call the Donaldsons up. They started with the Mother's Day teaching on marriage, and I don't know which way they're going, but the Bible study is all tied up with it, so they can do a whole lot of things. But as he comes, let's receive Dr. Donaldson. So I said amen. He looks like one, but let's say praise the Lord. Amen. God bless you, Dr.
Praise the Lord. Glory to God. Glory to God. Glory to God. You know, you all know and understand what I am all about. The Lord has really laid it on my heart to deal with this marriage thing. But today is Father's Day. Amen?
Amen.
Today is Father's Day, and we're going to do some things here that's going to kind of deal with both. Father's Day and marriage. Let me kind of get situated here, and I'll do what I gotta do. As you notice, as I said before, leading as example, you always get things situated as father, as the man, and then you call your wife or the woman into what you have prepared. So if you all can just kind of give a round of applause on Father's Day and just honor my wife as she comes up and joins me. The Lord has really laid on my heart to do this and start ministering us, ministering together. Because so much in the body of Christ right now, and so much in the world, couples are being separated. And you might see the man out front, and because of your lack of understanding, you'll understand that even though the man is out front, the man going to the war, the man getting the victory, the man is the conqueror. But when he comes home and presents it to a wife, that makes her what? More than a conqueror.
Amen.
So, even though that understanding that exists, Lord has laid on my heart to start bringing her further out front so you can see for yourselves the relationship between the man and the woman, the husband and the wife.
Yes.
Before I go further, you have anything you want to say? Can you stand real quick? Everybody stand. We're going to do a quick confession. Quick confession. Raise your Bible. We're going to get started here. And repeat after me. This is my Bible.
This is my Bible.
And my Bible says, the Bible says that I should say
what the Bible says.
So I say,
I am more than a conqueror.
I am blessed coming in.
Blessed going out.
Blessed in the field,
blessed in the field,
and blessed in the house.
I'm a major,
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 major blessing. Very good looking.
Anointed.
A major blessing going out.
To bless someone else.
The Lord just showed me something before I started. Have a seat. That's why I kind of stumbled. The Lord came over me and it kind of grabbed me because there's a major attack right now going on in marriage. Major attack. And some of it is real subtle. The Bible says we have a form of godliness, but no power. Well, if you've been in my class, that the marriage is that form of godliness that's in the image and likeness of God. But we got so many marriages walking around with no power. We got so many Christians walking around. And devil don't care. If you're an ineffective Christian, devil don't care. He lets you walk around, do what you want to do, and you're generally kind of carnal doing what you want to do anyway. But there's some things that kind of happen. Several things that kind of happened this week to some people that I love. I love you all, but fortunately, these people were kind of close, so I felt more of what was happening. There's deception going on out here. And we really need to get ourselves aware of it. And that deception comes in these three forms. I have to say this. Comes in the form of unbelief. It comes in the form of false doctrine. And it comes in the form that we miss, and a lot of us get sucked into it. Comes in the form of traditions of men. The Bible says, and says specifically, that it is the traditions of men, even though you might have the word, that it is traditions of men that make the word of none effect. So we're walking around here, we're doing things out of our traditions, what our foreparents did and what they said, instead of investigating and growing in that which Christ wants for us. Amen. So to keep this kind of light, because I can get heavy, because this area really touched me, so to keep it kind of light and help me keep it kind of light. And talking about this Father's Day, I want you all to kind of repeat after me, because every time I say, what am I talking about? I want you to say three things. I want you to say, fathers, the marriage, and the church.
Fathers, the marriage, and church.
Come on, you're going to get a little louder.
Fathers, the marriage, and church.
So when you hear me say, what am I talking about? You say,
fathers, the marriage, and church.
All right, that's good. We're going to take this a little further. We don't have much time because I have to initiate some of my little fatherly things here a little bit, so I'm not gonna rush through it, but Holy Spirit understands what we have to do. Today is a day where we celebrate Father's Day. Good fathers, bad fathers, saved fathers, just fathers. We honoring fathers on this day. But I'd like to bring out four things that we as fathers, and understanding, when I say fathers, that does not exclude mothers or your wife. Because I try, as I explained in the beginning, if I'm a conqueror, she's more than a conqueror. But I brought it up here so we can all be, express this thing together. So what am I talking about?
Fathers, marriage, and church.
I'm talking about fathers, marriage, and the church. So I want to bring out 4 points. That as fathers, as men, we should be about. And I don't want to get into it too deeply. I'm just going to give you a little scripture. And I want you to take these scriptures down and then study it for yourself. Men, generally, are builders. Whether you realize it or not, any and everything you get into you're building something. You're building relationships, or you're building something negative. You're building something. But as Christian men, we're going to approach this from a Christian men point of view. And you're going to turn to Proverbs 24, because the first aspect of actually building is preparation. So turn to Proverbs 24, 27. I'll have my wife read. You ready here?
Prepare thy work without and make it fit for thyself in the field, and afterwards build thy house.
That is the process that we must do. We must prepare. We don't automatically just jump into something and do something as fathers. Because you're still building now, even as a father, even as a grandfather. Your work, your position as a father, grandfather, the building aspect never stops. You're building that home. You're building that relationship. You're building that godly atmosphere. So before you get into stepping out as an individual man, before you get out stepping out into being a father, the first thing we need to do is prepare. Next thing we need to do, if you want to turn to me with Luke 14:26. I'm not going to preach on this too well. That's all. I want you to write these scriptures down and study them out for yourself.
Luke what?
Luke 14:26. And as you prepare and decide to bring someone into what you've been preparing, you must next count the cost. Everybody there? Read to me.
If any man come to me and hate not his father and mother and wife and children, and brethren, and sister, yea, and his own life also, he cannot be my disciple.
So you must understand that what you are preparing for is to put your whole self in, that there's nothing between you and God first. Not brother, not sister, not any relation. God always comes first. What am I talking about?
Father, marriage, and church.
Try that one more time. What am I talking about?
Father, marriage, and the church.
There you go. So, we're supposed to prepare first, and then we count the cost. And counting the cost, we make sure we're mature enough to take on the responsibilities of what we're preparing ourselves for. We say this a lot when dealing with sports, because sometimes our talent in sports, our talent can take us where our character can't keep us. So you got to build yourself up to where you are ready to handle what God has planned for you. What am I talking about? Understand, when I say fathers, I'm not excluding women or wives. Because it's kind of like if you try to exclude fathers from the wife, it's just kind of like trying to say you're going to separate the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. When you deal with one, you're dealing with the other. When you talk about one, you talk about the other. So when you give to me, you're giving to her. When you curse me, you're cursing her. When you say things bad about me, you're talking about her. Just like when we was growing up, I had five brothers, I didn't have any sisters, but you didn't mess with one of us. You did not mess with one of us. You didn't have to talk about my brother, get my brother to whip on you. You just talk about me. And my wife is the same way. My wife won't let nobody else fuss with me but her. See, tell her. She right. If you come with an attitude, she will step in and say, nobody fusses with him but me. So if one fusses with me, we got to go behind him. We got to go behind him. But no. But that's how love is. That's how it is. So preparation, count the cost. And then the third thing we want to get to, turn to Hebrews 3:4. It's in building. This is the first point I want to build. Express to you. It's in building.
Hebrews
3:4. Hebrews 3:4. We got a little feedback going here. Everybody there?
Yeah.
Okay, I'm gonna have my wife. I'll read that.
For every house is built by some man, but he that builds all things is God.
So don't just go out and build your house on your own. Don't just go out and be a builder relationships on your own. You've got to include God in this. If you don't include God in this, it can be very dangerous. Very dangerous. What am I talking about? in the marriage and in the church. If you're not including, and I've seen churches that don't include God. I've seen churches that are really carnal, where they think they don't have the Holy Spirit, so they think everything they can do is within themselves. They don't rely on the Holy Spirit. And when you go to one of their deacon meetings, if you're not strong within your faith, you will lose your religion, because they cuss like sailors. And that you would not believe what goes on in some of these deacon meetings. But it's only because they don't have the Holy Spirit. They're not relying on the Holy Spirit, because when you rely on yourself, what makes my point more valid than your point? And the only way we're going to come to the point is to argue it out, not going to the Holy Spirit to see what he wants. Because that's what men do. We build things. That's why the order is so important, that you must respect it. So those three things I brought out about building on the first point we do. We build, we prepare, we count the cost. Then we must get God involved. Next thing is, where are we going to build this? Where are we going to build it? Let's turn to Matthew 4:23. Yes, Lord. I have to bear with me, because God is telling me to keep it simple. Keep it light. Where are we going to build this? We all understand that we must build it on the rock. But where is this rock located? We know who the rock is, but where is this rock located? Everybody there? Say amen.
Amen.
Okay.
And Jesus went about all Galilee, teaching in their synagogue and preaching the gospel of the kingdom, and healing all manner of sickness and all manner of disease among the people.
So Jesus was teaching us where the rock was, knowing that he is the rock, and he is the rock that's in the kingdom. He can only teach you about where he is. So when we build our house, we got to build it on the rock, but we got to go to the rock. We got to get involved in the kingdom.
Amen.
We can't just sit out here outside the kingdom and say, well, that is the rock. I'm building my house on this firm foundation, this rock here, and it's not in the kingdom. I don't care if you call it whatever. If you're not acting, if you're not moving, if you're not existing in kingdom ways, you're not on the rock. You're on the sand. And so many of us get involved like that. So we want to build our house, but then we want to build it in the kingdom. Let's turn to Mark 1:4 also. 1:14, excuse me. That's why she's here. Mark 1:14. What am I talking about?
Fathers, marriage, and church.
Fathers, marriage, and the church. You can't separate it. You can't separate it. And when you study this out, I'm going to give you one scripture and show you. When you study this out, you can't separate it. Because a lot of us, how we relate to God is based on that relationship we have with our fathers. Yeah, some of us grow out of that, getting an understanding through the Word. But when we come into that relationship, if we haven't had that relationship with our earthly father, then our relationship with our heavenly father has been hammered. So what am I talking about?
Fathers, marriage, and the church.
I'm going to get this into you too. When you get out of here tomorrow, you get out here a little later, you sit there at the dinner table, what's going to come out of your mouth is father, marriage, and church. Where is that coming from? Fathers, marriage, and church. Okay, everybody there?
Yeah.
All right.
Now, after John was put in prison, Jesus came into Galilee preaching the gospel of the kingdom of God.
So understand how important it is. No matter what goes on in your life, we must establish ourselves in the kingdom. We must build our houses in the kingdom. Without doing a big study on that, like I said, I want to go through this and just give you a few scriptures. The kingdom is God's way of doing things, not your way of doing things. A lot of us is getting off into our way of doing things, and you're going to have to research. If you come to my marriage class, that's why I deal with my marriage class the way I do, because I want to give you a foundation so you understand why God is doing things the way he does it. This thing, marriage, is really nothing to play with. This thing, marriage, it's a reflection of God himself, of the Father, Son, the Holy Spirit here on earth. You're supposed to bring heaven here on earth. As Jesus said, say in our prayer, say that it shall be done here on earth as it is in heaven. Well, how is it done in heaven? You have the relationship of the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit governing what goes on in heaven. You have a relationship of man, wife, and Holy Spirit governing what goes on in the family. Because once you establish that godly family, the church comes easy. The church comes easy. What am I talking about?
Father, Spirit, and church.
So, first we got to build our house, and we got to prepare, we got to count the cost, and then we get God involved. Then we have to build our house in the kingdom.
Yes.
Upon that rock.
Yes.
Established by Jesus Christ.
Amen.
It takes a little sacrifice in this world right now, because this world is attacking marriages like it's going out of style. The divorce rate is right around 52%. We don't even want to look at the divorce rate, because Nisa and I do counseling, and if you get out there and see what's going on with marriages, the spiritual and the emotional divorce rate is probably right around 85-90%. They might be still legally together, but they're not walking together. They're not operating in kingdom principles together. And then let me throw this in here too, because if you understand the marriage, if you really understand and accept it and believe it with no unbelief, the way the marriage is set up, it'll show you everything that goes on and everything in the Bible, and deception becomes very, very hard to do, because it won't line up. It's not in order. And we have a lot of good people out here, got a little word, so you can't just, I said they're godly, a little carnal, they're godly, so you don't just throw them, the baby out with the bath water. You gotta learn how to chew the straw and spit out the sticks, because we all are growing and learning. And sometimes, people who hasn't quite grown yet get in positions, and they start to teach with a little lack of understanding. Because I've heard big ministers, I mean multi-mega church ministers, take this subject of marriage and just, because it wasn't their anointing, making all kind of comments. This is one comment that kind of creates that wedge. My better half. If she's the better half and I'm the head, where is that putting me? And now I got to make decisions. I'm supposed to act like the head. You've hampered me. You're putting this weight on my head, telling me to make decisions, but I'm not the head, the better half. And if that's the better half, then you make it. So we have a lot of that going on in marriages. And it's been taught, and we don't understand a lot of these statements we've made is causing that wedge.
There's another saying also, it's like, if mama's not happy, then nobody's happy. So what does that do? That puts all of everything on the wife. You know, like she is the ruler and not and the head.
And it happens to man again, because now you can't minister to your wife. Now you can't minister to your family, because everything is going to flow according to her feelings. Not her spirituality, her feelings. But that, see, that's that wedge again. The devil is very subtle. We can break that down. Because God's going to bring about some marriages. But let me go ahead. I don't have much time here. So we're going to build a house. We're going to build a house in preparation. We're going to count the cost. We're going to get God involved. Then we're going to build our house in the kingdom. In God's kingdom. On that rock called Jesus Christ. Now we know that houses consist of mortar and brick. But this house we're going to build consists of not mortar and brick, but some spiritual thing. Let's go to Hebrews 11:1 now. And we're going to give you the substance of which we're going to build this house out of. Hebrews 11:1. Keep forgetting you got a mind. Everybody there? Everybody ready? Amen. Say amen.
Amen.
What are we talking about?
Fire, marriage, and church.
There we go.
Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen.
So when you start to build this house, fathers, in your preparation and you're placing it on that rock, you got to do it in faith. Because the substance of what this house is made of is faith. Faith in God. Faith in the kingdom. And if you don't have that faith in God, like I said, the number one of the main things that are causing Christians to be deceived is unbelief. If you don't have that belief, that faith in God, when you read the word, just accept it as what it is and what it says, not trying to twist it and bend it to fit you, but you understanding that you're not mature, so you need to grow to fit it. Sometimes change hurts a little bit. But we have a Holy Spirit that is here to comfort us. He's not here for no reason to comfort. He understands that as we grow, we're going to go through trials and tribulations and things are going to hurt us. Even His Word and trying to adapt to His Word is going to bring a little hurt upon us. But He's there to comfort us. So faith is the next point that gives us the substance to build this house. What am I talking about?
Fathers, marriage, and the church.
Let's go to Hebrews 11:6.
But without faith, it is impossible to please Him. For he that cometh to God must believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of them that diligently seek Him.
Did you hear that? So in building your house of faith, you got a helper called God Himself. Because as you seek Him to acquire the material to build this house, He's going to provide for you.
Yes.
He's going to do for you. He's going to soften your burden. He's going to fight your battles.
Yeah.
All you have to do is believe that He is, faith. Believe that He is, and that He is a rewarder of those who diligently seek Him.
Amen.
What am I talking about?
Fathers, marriage, church.
Fathers, believe. Marriages, believe. And the church will come easy. So the next thing that we have to have, my fourth point, that I kind of touched on, let's go to Galatians 5:6 first. You there? Are you there?
Yes.
Galatians 5:6.
For in Jesus Christ, neither circumcision availeth anything, nor uncircumcision, but faith that worketh by love.
Faith. You got to have it, but you can't do without it, or manipulate it, or use it if you don't have love. Love is the main thing that holds this house together. And when I taught you in my marriage class, those of you who have been there, love is God. Amen. Not only that, he didn't stop there, but he gave you a spirit of love. But we let our intellect influence us so much, dominate our spirit, that we don't walk in that love like we should. We need to go over here to the other side, and I'm going to do a teaching on this because we got so far away from it. Because we think we're so bad now, you don't mess with me at all. And we think we walk in love when you do that. But when the Bible says, turn the other cheek. Bible says if they steal one coat, give them the other. We don't teach much on that anymore. That is humility. When you can turn the other cheek, when you can let somebody have something that they don't desire or deserve to have, when they think they're just ripping you off, and you just step back and say, hey, go ahead, enjoy yourself. Been there. I don't lend money. I give it to you. You come to me and say, Michael, can I borrow $100? Yeah, sure. Here, boom. Don't worry about paying me back. Because I'm not going to open up an opportunity for you to falter and slip and think you're going to be getting away with something with me. I'm not going to open that door. If I can't give it, I can't. You can't. We say, you can't get it. That's my son, Dave. I love him so much. He keeps me on my toes. But if I can't give it, you can't get it. You shouldn't be giving it. I shouldn't be giving it. Because I don't want to cause any rift. The Bible teaches us that we should, as Christians, run from strife. Strife is another killer that just destroys relationships. Run from strife. We're supposed to love and forgive. Yes. So we're building this house. Fathers, we're building this house. And in building, we got to prepare. We got to count the cost. We got to get involved, God involved. And so number two, we must build this house on the rock, but on the rock that's in the kingdom. And we must build it in kingdom ways. And we must also take faith to establish this house on this rock in kingdom ways. And then we use love to work our faith. Love is like the tool that we use to work the mortar. You know what I'm saying? Faith is the mortar, the substance. But love is the tool that we use to work that mortar, build that house, yes, put that stucco, put, yes, that drywall up.
Yes.
We got to have that love. I got one more scripture for you. Galatians 5:22.
But the fruit of the Spirit is love, joy, peace, long-suffering, gentleness, goodness, faith, meekness, temperance. Against such there is no law.
The fruit of the Spirit. How do I know I have love? Because I'm going to bear this fruit. And when I bear this fruit, I'm hanging up patience on my wall that I have built. I'm hanging up long suffering on my wall that God has helped me build. I'm hanging up temperance on my wall that God has helped me build. And when I get it all built, I turn to that woman that I had to choose, because the Bible says when I choose a woman, I've chosen a good thing. So I turn to that good thing with patience, with temperance, with love. And I bring it into the house that God has helped me to build. Then we do the thing that God told us to do. He told us to go out to be fruitful and multiply.
Amen.
Multiply what? More godly kids. women and men that are standing strong in the word of the God, not coming up through the back door, but coming out on the front door, proclaiming who he really is.
Amen.
Proclaiming who he really is. So, men, this is your day. But it's not a day for you to throw your shoulders up and say who I am. Because who you are is nothing without her. Who you are is nothing without God. Who you are is nothing without the Holy Spirit. And who you are is nothing if you don't understand that the house you are building is either going to be in Satan's camp or in God's kingdom.
Yes, camp.
One more scripture. I want you to go to Malachi 4. Because I'm going to give you just a little encouragement. What am I talking about?
Fathers, marriage, church.
Talking about fathers, marriage, and the church. And if you study this out, Ephesians will show you that there's no difference between the marriage and the church and kingdom order. Fathers, to be honest so much, when you became saved, God no longer became God, he became Father God. So there's been a mantle placed upon your head when you've been called Father, to live up to the Father. And he's not giving you something you cannot do. He's told you to be holy. He didn't tell you to be holy because you couldn't do it. He's giving you a Holy Spirit, a spirit of love. You just have to submit to it. Get off your egos trying to dominate. Malachi 4. Let's go to 4. Let's just do it at 4:4 for time's sake. Let's do it at 4:4. Everybody there? Malachi 4:4. This is an encouragement to you, men. Because it ain't going to be this way much longer. We're in those last. It's not. Read for me.
Remember ye the law of Moses, my servant, which I command unto him in Horeb, for all Israel, with the statutes and judgments. Behold, I will send you Elijah the prophet before the coming of the great and dreadful day of the Lord. And he shall turn the hearts of the fathers to the children, and the hearts of the children to their father, lest I come and smite the earth with a curse.
Understand what I said before. You can't have a father without a mother, okay? The Bible puts the father or the man out front for a reason. But when he speaks about the man in terms of the father, he's not discarding the woman. What they're talking about here, the family's coming back together.
Yes.
In godly ways.
Amen.
In kingdom ways.
Amen.
And if you don't want to accept that, if you want to do it your way, then you're going to begin to walk in the curse. So men who are struggling and hurting and trying to establish this kingdom, they don't give up. Don't give up. Just get your eyes off the world and put your eyes on Christ. Women of husbands that seem to be getting discouraged, don't give up on them. Keep them out there making those decisions so they become confident in themselves and make. Don't just jump up and take away that which they have. So I gave you a few points here on this Father's Day, just to kind of inspire and to let you know what's going on in terms of this world, in terms of what God is doing with us, and also to give you a kind of a direction on Father's Day to understand that as fathers, you are affecting this whole society. As wives, you are affecting this whole society, because how we go is how the society goes. If you see all this stuff going on out here, because it came out of a marriage. Donald Trump came out of a marriage. Hitler came out of a marriage. Stalin came out of a marriage, but so did Martin Luther King. So did Jesus Christ. That's why the woman is double covered, because she is the interest into this world. The legal interest into this world. You have anything you want to say before we end this? You sure? You want to say nothing to these men out here about being fathers for me?
Okay, I do have something to say. Men, Michael just said that women are the entrance into this world. But men, you are the seed bearer.
Yes, yes, yes.
Without you, there won't be a baby. So you all are very, very important, because you are the seed bearer. You understand that?
Yes, yes.
The seed bearer. So we should, you know, the society talks about sticks and stones and may break my bones, and boys are just, you know, all troublemakers and stuff. But that's not how God sees you. In God's eyes, He trusts you to be the seed bearer. That's an important responsibility, to be the seed bearer. And on that responsibility, He wants you to decide who's going to be the bearer of your seed. So that's a significant decision that you make as well. So, men, we honor you today. Can we have all the men stand up right now? Let's honor our seed bearers, seed holders. There's not too many of you all. Let's come up and let's pray for all the men today.
Have all the men come up, all the fathers come up. Everybody stand, please. Bible speaks about, to paraphrasing, to conquer the house, you must first destroy or tear down the strong man of the house. So I'm coming to you. I want everybody to lift their hands out to these men. I want to pray for them that God keeps them strong. Not only just in their bodies, but in their spirit. Father God, in the name of Jesus, we come to you right now knowing that you are God and God all by yourself. Knowing that you have created the way and the only way. Wide is that road of destruction, but narrow is the road unto salvation and unto you through Jesus Christ. That road is not narrow, prohibiting a lot of people from coming through. It's narrow because it's a designation of order. Chaos exists, Father, in the wideness, but there's order in your narrowness, Father. So we thank you for it right now. And ask you to open up the eyes in each and every man that is up here, that they may see and come to understand you, not just as God, but as Father God. Establishing that relationship that they put you first, but above all.
Yes.
And then putting you first, that they understand that the woman in their life comes next.
Yes.
And they know how to treat that woman in their life. But it's all hinging on you, Father God, and opening up to our eyes. So we just thank you. We give you praise and glory. Oh, Shady Amado, for being God and for these men. And everybody say amen.
Amen.
Say amen.
Amen.
Say amen.
Amen.
Thank you. What am I talking about?
Father's marriage in the church.
Fathers, if you you get yourself involved with God, you will get a godly woman and build a marriage, and then this church thing will come easy. Come easy. Thank you. God bless you all. I'm going to turn it back over to Pastor Hill. Happy Father's Day. And as you go out, not just the fathers that you know, but men that you know, period, as fathers, just tell them Happy Father's Day.
All right. We thank God for a word in due season for the brothers, for the fathers. It's been a great service. Amen. How many have been blessed?
Yes.
No fathers. You ought to have your chest sticking out today. Amen. Going back home, get a very sumptuous meal. Your wife going to hand out everything. Amen. Climax with a steak dinner, or I guess. We have a lot to look forward, if not a steak dinner prepared by the wife. They'll be taking you out, so I'm sure that fathers are in for a great treatment. How many appreciate the Spirit of the Lord today, and the word that was brought and ministered? Amen. We just thank God for the word of God today. All right, Sister Thurl, I guess, has some form of distributing the gifts. I don't know how she's going to go about it. I see a whole lot of items in the rear. Maybe I better get in line first. All right, well, God bless you, everyone. Stand. Thank God we, amen, have had a glorious session today, glorious service. We thank God for the Spirit of the Lord and all those things that came together. Amen. To glorify the Lord. Amen. Praise and worship was great. And everything was good. And everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise
the Lord. Amen. Now unto him that is able to keep us from falling and to present us faultless before his presence with exceeding great joy, to the only wise God be glory, honor, dominion, and power both now and forever. Everybody said, praise the Lord.
Praise the Lord.
Amen. God bless you. Happy Father's Day. Amen. Enjoy the rest of the day. Amen. Fathers have gifts waiting them in the rear. Courtesy of Sister Thurl and Sister Thurl. God bless you.
But that's not how God sees you. God sees you. In God's eyes, he trusts you to be the seed bearer. That's an important responsibility, to be the seed bearer. And on that responsibility, he wants you to decide who's going to be the bearer of your seed. So that's a significant decision that you make as well. So, men, we honor you today.